Melinda Audio present this unabridged recording of Weathering the Storm, written by Gael Lindenfield and read by Amy Noble. To Stuart, my husband, whose unfailing support and consistently positive outlook underpins my own morale and has helped me through so many difficult times. Introduction. I am writing this at what is, for many of us collectively, the most challenging time that we will experience in our lifetimes. The world is currently in lockdown due to the COVID-19 pandemic, and people across the globe are at home, isolated from their loved ones, and uncertain about what the future holds in terms of their health, career, finances, and relationships. This situation has brought many of the issues covered in this book into sharp focus. For some, stuck at home with no connection to the outside world, this is a time of great loneliness and isolation, where reaching out and making connection seems impossible. For others, being trapped in close proximity with spouses, partners, family members, or housemates has its own challenges, with the usual irks and gratings of cohabitation being magnified tenfold by the inability to escape and reclaim headspace. Many others are struggling financially, having lost their jobs or having had business opportunities go by the wayside. Others still are sick with worry about their loved ones, who they can no longer visit and care for, at risk of spreading the disease. The list goes on. The bulk of this book was written before the spread of the pandemic, and though in a few short weeks the world has changed to a remarkable degree, the messages and lessons you will find within these pages are more relevant than ever. When planning this book, I wanted to create an easily digestible manual of tips and tools aimed at specifically addressing low morale during tough times. It seemed to me that when tackling these issues, the negative influences that sap at our confidence and sense of self-worth can be split into two distinct halves, internal and external. With that in mind, this book has two parts. Part one looks at our inner life and covers everything from mastering the negative voices in our heads to understanding our deep emotional triggers so that we can recognize and avoid issues before they arise. The second half of the book looks at our outer life and the external influences that can chip away at us on a daily basis. This section covers everything from our immediate environment and how it can be changed to positively impact on our mood, to the food that we eat, our relationships, both personal and professional, overcoming financial worries, and harnessing our creativity as an outlet for stress and negativity. With any luck, by the time that this book comes out, the world will be a more positive place and we will have learned from this troubling time. Whatever the situation, my deepest hope is that this book will help you see through to clearer skies ahead and that the information contained within these pages will help you weather the storm and let the sunshine in once more. Disclaimer. Trigger encourages diversity and different viewpoints. However, all views, thoughts, and opinions expressed in this book are the author's own and are not necessarily representative of Trigger as an organization. All material in this book is set out in good faith for general guidance, and no liability can be accepted for loss or expense incurred in following the information given. In particular, this book is not intended to replace expert medical or psychiatric advice. It is intended for informational purposes only, and for your own personal use and guidance. It is not intended to diagnose, treat, or act as a substitute for professional medical advice. The author is not a medical practitioner nor a counselor, and professional advice should be sought if desired before embarking on any health-related program. Part 1. Inner Life. Chapter 1. Getting to Know Yourself. In times of great stress, the cacophony of voices and opinions can seem deafening, and it can be hard to take stock of your own thoughts and feelings against this onslaught. At times like these, you need to step back, take a deep breath, and focus on your voice inside your head before you are able to take anyone else's opinions on board. Being aware of your own feelings will also allow you to recognize potential triggers and quell rising emotions before they escalate into a crescendo. The exercises in this chapter will help you find your inner voice and give your feelings space to form before taking those of others on board. Play to your strengths. When I dare to be powerful, to use my strength in the service of my vision, then it becomes less and less important whether I am afraid. Audre Lorde, poet. We all have our own unique package of personal strengths, and one of the big secrets of confident people is that they know precisely what is in their package and how to use each strength to advantage in any given situation. In contrast, people who lack confidence are super aware of their weaknesses and spend most of their energy on either attempting to improve these or hide them. Your self-confidence has probably been rocked by whatever problem you have right now. You need to give it some boosts. This exercise will help by reminding you how you can use your strengths to help you in this situation. If you struggle to come up with enough examples of your strengths, seek help from a good friend immediately. It is crucial to confidence to be able to keep your best inner resources at the forefront of your mind. List 3 to 6 of your personal strengths in each of the categories listed on the following 2 pages, and beside each one, note down how they could help get you through this difficult period. The examples will give you an idea of how to do this exercise, but remember that your strengths may be very different, although no less useful. My innate talents and aptitudes. Musical. Helps to relax or energize me. Strengthens social contacts by giving free pleasure to others. An accurate eye. Tennis. Keeps me fit and releases tension. Can make new contacts at club. Creativity. Can draw my own Christmas card to save money. Revamp the sitting room cheaply to boost my mood. Use painting to relax me. Drama to practice interview skills. My core character strengths. Persistence. Can keep going even when I become bored or tired, so I could do a boring fill-in job while waiting. I can fight through bureaucracy to check my full entitlement to help. Sense of humour. Can cheer up others, keep my perspective, divert my attention from worry. Optimism. Can spot opportunities, keep self and others motivated. My special skills. IT. Opens research possibilities. Can network more widely. Work from home or anywhere in the world. Online courses. Selling. Can promote myself. Apply for wider range of jobs. Get best price for flat if we need to sell. Listening. Can make new friends. Elicit ideas from others. Collaborate with others in the same boat. Numeracy. Helps with redoing the budget. Calculating real value of bargain. Offering to be treasurer of residents' association and gain more power over decision making. Cooking. Diversion from problems. Make interesting meals from cheap ingredients. Sell homemade cakes, jams, and sauces, or use for presents. Entertain possible good contacts. Project management. View this problem as a project with a start point, milestones, and finish point. Keep organized and focused. Review progress. Quick fix. Celebrate the uncelebrated. Few people celebrate their achievements adequately. Normally, only certain successes are routinely deemed worthy of celebration, such as past exams, new jobs, or winning competitions. However, in the field of personal development, these may not be the achievements that people consider to be their greatest. Here are some examples of what people have told me they regard as achievements. None of them was celebrated at the time, but they certainly deserved to be. Being a good parent. Having a good relationship with your partner.
Keeping the peace with the in-laws.
Becoming fluent in a language. Mastering the computer. Going solo on holiday. Getting over a divorce or separation. Overcoming a fear of flying. Growing roses in unfriendly soil. Making a beautiful home. Learning how to keep cool with the boss. Becoming well organized instead of living in chaos. Becoming a good manager or leader. This should prompt a belated celebration for some of your own achievements. Stop stress in its tracks. Tension is who you think you should be. Relaxation is who you are. Chinese proverb. Everyone now knows that stress is bad news. The research findings about its threat to health and life expectancy are always making headlines. And from your own life experience, you'll also know that it depresses your mood, disturbs relationships, and is an arch enemy of progress. So why does it so often get the better of us, even during the good times? Stress builds stealthily, and in its earliest stages produces sensations that feel great and often make you perform more effectively. The initial adrenaline rush is energizing. It lifts your mood and makes you feel more confident, if not arrogant. And after this, there is no stopping or turning back. You are deaf to any feedback and too excited or busy for introspection. The secret to stopping stress before it spirals down to burnout is to be alert to the symptoms that indicate a descent has just begun. There are slight negative changes that can be sensed and observed, which at this stage have few, if any, serious consequences. Once past this critical phase, however, most people have to sink to a point where hurtful damage has set in before they will consider taking action. Of course, during difficult times, you are even more vulnerable to stress, so it will pay big dividends to carry out a regular spot check on yourself, which you can do very quickly using the checklist that follows. The following early symptoms are common ones, some of which you will almost surely have experienced, while others you may not. Much depends on your health, age, and personality. You can also add a few of your own symptoms if you have identified any that are not listed. Show this checklist to your partner and/or friends too. They may be able to spot the signs earlier than you will. Early warning stress signals. Physical signals include tension headaches, especially those which persist when you are at rest, shallower breathing, less energy, perhaps taking the car or bus when it is easy to walk, sweating more, unusual bowel movements, pins and needles when you stand or wake up, loss of libido, making the proverbial excuses, more frequent viruses, increase in allergic reactions, aching back or shoulders, restless legs and hands, cold hands and feet, increased PMT, and congested sinuses. Emotional signals might include increased anxiousness, moodiness for no apparent reason, more pessimistic, not finding jokes so funny, persistent guilty thoughts, obsessive habits such as wanting to check and recheck, feelings more easily hurt, apathy, saying, I don't mind, more often. Mistrustfulness, wondering about ulterior motives. Cynicism, making sneering remarks, negatively generalizing. Overexcitement, having a one-track mind about an idea, being dismissive of alternatives. Depersonalization, feeling at a distance from the world around you. Mind or behavior symptoms might include concentration wandering more, inattentiveness, switching off when others are talking, reclusiveness, not joining others at lunch, partying is less appealing, increased alcohol intake, increased smoking, outbursts of irritation, making gratuitous biting remarks, less careful about appearance, indecisiveness, letting others decide for you, more cautious, saying, I'm not sure, more often. reluctance to delegate, making mountains out of molehills, going to bed later than usual, untidiness, being unable to find things, disturbed sleep, restless, not refreshed after sleep, and a change in attitude to money, more spendthrift or frugal for no good reason. If you have ticked more than a couple of boxes, it's time to chill out a little. Don't just try to kid yourself that you can control the symptom or symptoms. However good your intention, it is unlikely to last without making some lifestyle change. This book is filled with many ideas that are quick and easy to implement, so no excuses. Start experimenting now to find out which work best for you. Go for good enough. Striving for excellence motivates you. Striving for perfection is demoralizing. Harriet Breaker, psychologist and author. The chances are that if you are listening to this book, you have a tendency to be a perfectionist. I'm making this guess because the majority of my clients who struggle through tough times have had this characteristic. To see if I've guessed right, listen to the following statements and tick the boxes that could apply to you. You tend to set goals and standards for yourself that are so high that they become a strain on your time, energy, or money, and some of your relationships. You find it hard to take a compliment without doubting the giver's sincerity, or their ability as a true judge, or thinking or commenting on some aspect that could be improved. You dwell on mistakes and failures for longer than most people, and are not at ease when others try to comfort you. You feel you could or should have done better, even though people are continually telling you that you have done well, or you know your results are better than the average. You believe that aiming for perfection is the key to success and should always be your goal. You hate deadlines and wait until the very last minute to make decisions or hand in work, so you have the option to make any last-minute changes. You have packed schedules and less relaxation than most people. You become irritated or angered by others who do things which are not up to your standards, even when it is not your responsibility to judge or supervise them. You focus more on your own and others' weaknesses rather than strengths. You have at least one self-improvement project on the go, and more in the pipeline. If not, you feel guilty. The higher your score out of 10, the more of a perfectionist you are. And if you are now questioning the validity of this simple assessment, you can add another 3 ticks to your score and read on. If your score was very low, however, I would urge you to continue listening in any case, as this will give you an idea of how to help others who have this trait. And now, the confession. I am a perfectionist myself, and highly attracted to other perfectionists and perfect creations, so I have great empathy for you. But I also know that during tough times, this is something that can render you more vulnerable to stress, being burnt out, pessimistic, and feeling isolated and unsupported. I'm not going to suggest that you give up your perfectionism completely, though. You need to simply tame it, especially in difficult times. The following exercise will give you a checklist that you can refer to whenever necessary to ensure that you stay on a good enough track most of the time. I assure you that doing this will free up considerable time, energy, and possibly money. It will also make it much easier for you to collaborate with anyone who is helping you. Quick fix. View the big picture of your potential. Imagine that you are 80 years old. A large group of friends and ex-colleagues are throwing a party for you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.